The Upper Sangro River Valley in central Italy, 85 miles north of Naples. The Abruzzo Mountains soar to more than 5,000 feet. In the summer, city dwellers travel here for peace and to escape the heat. In winter, they come to ski. Sometimes it snows more heavily in Capricotta than anywhere else in Europe. At the end of 1943, this was the Allied front line, and it was held by the Irish Brigade of the British Army. The Allies had hoped to be in Rome by Christmas, but instead the Irish Brigade spent it here, amid snow and under enemy fire. My name is Richard O'Sullivan, and this is part four of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War. On the 3rd of September 1943, Allied armies started to invade the mainland of Italy. Italy joined the Allies as a co-belligerent on the 8th. 2 weeks later, the Irish Brigade's marching troops sailed from Sicily for Taranto in southern Italy. The Irish Brigade was formed in early 1942. It comprised the 1st Battalion of the Royal Irish Fusiliers, known as the Fogs, the 6th Battalion of the Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers, known as the Skins, also based in Northern Ireland, and the 2nd Battalion of the London Irish Rifles, which came from London. Most of the original members of the brigade were Irish-born or of Irish descent. The Tunisian campaign was the brigade's baptism of fire. It lost around 1,000 men, either killed, wounded, missing or taken prisoner, in battles between November 1942 and the fall of Tunis in May 1943. In July 1943, the brigade joined the successful 38-day campaign to capture Sicily. London Irish Rifles Colour Sergeant Ted O'Sullivan, a Londoner conscripted into the British Army in October 1939, recalled the sea voyage to Taranto in his memoirs.
"We sailed through the Strait of Messina and up to Taranto, where we disembarked and waited for about 5 days. We travelled by train to Barletta, where we were introduced to vermouth at ridiculously low prices. So far, it had been soft."
That was soon to change. On the 1st of October, the 8th Army reached the German Barbara Line. It ran from the Volturno River north of Naples, through the Apennine Mountains to the mouth of the Biferno River near Termoli on the Adriatic coast. To outflank it, commandos and special forces landed behind German lines in Termoli on the 3rd of October and were later joined by elements of the 78th Division travelling by land from the south. 2 days later, the Irish Brigade left Barletta on a 10-hour sea journey to the town. It was told Termoli was secure. It wasn't.
"We embarked into landing craft in battle order and were carried around the cape formed by Mount Gargano to Termoli. Here we were dumped on an inhospitable quay with shells exploding around us. The reception was so warm, the Navy did not bother to unload a medical unit complete with stretchers. They just backed out and left. We ran quickly up the cobbled streets carrying everything. The platoons were hurriedly deployed. We dashed into a large hotel building which was occupied by the remains of a commando troop that had taken the port. My staff joined me and were delighted with the luxurious accommodation we had in Termoli."
This is the hotel that Ted O'Sullivan and the quartermaster team of E Company of the London Irish Rifles occupied on the night of the 5th of October. The Irish Brigade had arrived just in time. A German attack that involved more than 20 tanks had started earlier that day.
By sunrise, all three battalions of the Irish Brigade were deployed north and west of Termoli. The fogs held positions round the brickworks on the road from the town. They were at the scent of a German counterattack involving the battle-hardened 16th Panzer Division. The fogs were supported by a squadron of Shermans from the Canadian Three Rivers Regiment. The fighting around Termoli on the 6th of October 1943 was the largest tank battle in Italy in the Second World War. It was the first battle for Fogg's captain, Lawrence Franklin Vale. He was an Australian living in London, who joined the British Army at the start of the war.
The Germans launched a surprise attack on the area occupied by my company. We had to crawl down a ditch with bullets zipping over our heads and banging up against the brick wall behind. I extracted the company from this unpleasant position without a single casualty. Subsequently, we put in a very successful attack. We took prisoners, and a very dejected lot they were, only too anxious to help in any way, and nothing of Prussianism or Nazism about them. It's curious how impersonal one feels. No feelings of hate towards them, just a matter of doing the job in hand.
While the Fogs fought off the attack, the Skins took San Giacomo to the left. The London Irish advanced to a cemetery overlooking the Adriatic, and then to the Sinarca River. This is the road from Termoli to San Giacomo, and behind me is the brickworks, the scene of heavy fighting involving the Fogs, and supported by Canadian tanks, on the 6th of October 1943. By the end of the day, the battle for Termoli was over. The Irish Brigade suffered more than 130 casualties in fighting around the town. It held the line north of Termoli for more than a week, while the 8th Army prepared to go on to the offensive. Percy Hamilton, a platoon commander in C Company, investigated the aftermath of the battle.
There were two dead Jerrys in the turret of a knocked-out tank. One was holding a book open, as if he had been reading when the tank was hit. Both were missing their heads. One from the neck up, and the other had lost the upper half. The inside of the turret looked as if it had been spattered with woolly beef.
The next objective was a ridge 5 miles to the north, overlooking the Trigno River. Its strong point was Patasiato. On the night of the 19th of October, the London Irish captured the town after a heavy bombardment. There were no casualties. The next target was to be much more challenging. A German defensive line had been created on another ridge, which overlooked the Trigno from the north. Its strong point was the town of San Salvo. But first, the Irish Brigade had to capture the bridge to the town over the Trigno.
The Fogs were ordered to capture the bridge leading to San Salvo, but a C Company under Major Tommy Woods approached the bridge on the 22nd of October. It went up, as he said at the time, like Vesuvius at the top of her form.
The Fogs forded the river by foot. 4 days later, the London Irish replaced them in the bridgehead. That night, Ted O'Sullivan led mules with supplies across the Trigno to E Company.
The silence was eerie and the darkness complete. At my destination, I was horrified when the outgoing officer lit a cigarette. The flashing of his lighter must have been seen for miles. On the way back from the company's lines that night, Sikh muleteers stopped in the Trikno and washed their mules. They were immediately heavily shelled, and some were killed. I waited until it was quiet and walked alone back to the mule point in pitch blackness. I crossed the Trikno ford, in which there were now bodies.
The bridgehead was the starting point for an attack on San Salvo Ridge. The job was given to the Fogs and the London Irish. They set off on the night of the 27th of October behind a crawling barrage. The advance was hampered by mud created by a downpour that day. The barrage had missed machine gun nests. German shelling pounded the Fogs with pre-registered fire. Fogs commanding officer Beecham Butler was hit by machine gun bullets and killed as he encouraged his men forward. The battalion was forced to withdraw. More than 25 Fogs died in the failed attack. They included A Company commander Major Paddy Proctor, a former Irish Guards Sergeant Major, who had been awarded the Military Cross in Sicily, and B Company commander Dennis Dunn. The London Irish were also repulsed. The battalions returned to the Trikno bridgehead. Franklin Verl later wrote about the attack to his wife Olive at home in Britain. His close comrade, Lieutenant John Glennie, a 20-year-old from Enniskillen in County Fermanagh, was seriously wounded in the battle. Franklin Verl tried to comfort him as they waited for a stretcher.
As he lay there in my arms, he kept on saying at intervals, "Frank, Frank, Frank." It was the only name he mentioned until he cried for his mother just before the end. That was, I suppose, my reward, to have produced the love that consciously or otherwise could think of me as he lay dying. Honestly, Olive, it is simply a ghastly business. You just cannot conceive at home how bad it is. Good life after good life goes. Men who have been out here all the time say that the fighting here is very much worse than in North Africa or Sicily.
In the exposed bridgehead, the brigade suffered further casualties. London Irish second in command, Major Kevin O'Connor, a Cambridge University graduate, educated at Ampleforth School, was killed in an artillery barrage. He was popular and respected. His death was another huge blow for the brigade. A fresh attack on San Salvo was prepared. This time, it involved 7 of the 9 battalions of the 78th Division, including the Skins, while the Fogs and the London Irish rested. Percy Hamilton recalled that it began with a massive bombardment before dawn on the 3rd of November.
We had been given a rum ration of 2-pint bottles per platoon. It was impossible to share it out in mugs, so I gave each fellow who wanted a swig out of the bottle. When the barrage opened, there was a flicker of flame across the whole skyline behind us. The tracer firing was so bright as to make it dangerous.
The attack was successful, and the Skins entered San Salvo that evening. With the weather worsening, the division pressed ahead and reached the River Sangro on the morning of the 9th of November. Ted O'Sullivan arrived in the area towards the end of the month.
The Sangro was in full spate with great tree trunks and other debris, and it filled the valley's width of about 3/4 of a mile. The Germans had once again harnessed nature to hold up our advance.
The Sangro Valley was dominated by strong German positions on a ridge that extended from Mazagronia in the west to the Adriatic. This was the eastern section of the Winter Line, which ran across the Italian peninsula from the Tyrrhenian Sea, past Monte Cassino, to the Adriatic. It was a formidable obstacle, in places 10 miles deep. 8th Army Commander General Bernard Montgomery's problems were compounded by rain and mud. On the 19th of November, companies from 36th Brigade crossed the Sangro, but but were forced back into a small bridgehead on the river's north bank. The decision was taken to use a larger force to capture the ridge after bridges had been built and tanks brought over the Sangro. The attack began on the night of the 27th of November with a massive aerial and artillery bombardment. The 8th Indian Division was deployed. Its 17th Brigade climbed the ridge to Mozegronia, took the town, and pushed on to its next targets. German defenders, supported by tanks and flamethrowers, drove the attackers back to Mozegronia, which the brigade held tenaciously. The German line had been damaged, but not broken. A new plan called for the Irish Brigade, supported by the 4th Armoured Brigade, to capture San Maria, east of Mozegronia, and attack along the ridge towards the sea. The assault began after dawn on the 29th of November, with the Skins in the lead. During the attack, two shells from a self-propelled gun landed in the gully where two platoons of the Fogs were assembling. 19 died, 27 were wounded. The assault on the ridge continued the next morning. The London Irish advanced from the Sangro and led the brigade along the ridge into Fosakesia. Working closely with tanks and the divisional artillery, the battalion captured enemy positions, many of them by surprise. They had expected a frontal assault.
I travelled along the road from Mozegronia soon after the attack and saw funeral ghats for the many Indians killed on the 28th of November. I arrived in Fosakesia as the company moved a piano into the street. One of the lads was playing it.
Two companies commanded by Major Jimmy Clark had marched overnight and reached San Vito, which was 2 miles behind enemy lines. The Fox Patrol, led by Lieutenant John Day, was greeted enthusiastically by the town's residents. But the Germans were still there. The patrol fought in the streets all day. Company Sergeant Major Crowley, Corporal Hughes, and Fusilier Muldoon were awarded the Military Medal. Fusilier William Haddon was awarded the Military Medal for the second time. Lieutenant Day died at San Vito and was recommended for the Victoria Cross for exceptional valour. The town was finally taken on the 3rd of December, and the Irish Brigade fought their way to the Moro River, the next formidable barrier in the 8th Army's way. This is San Vito, just to the south of the Moro River, which marked the furthest point that the Irish Brigade reached during the Adriatic campaign. It had been on the front line for 2 months and had suffered more than 800 casualties since it landed in Termini. On the 5th of December, the Canadian Division took over the advance. Canadian troops pressed north into the coastal town of Altona. Bitter fighting continued until the advance was suspended south of Pescara during a snowstorm on the 31st of December 1943. The weather and unexpectedly determined opposition made further progress impossible before the spring. Most of the men of the Irish Brigade who were killed in the Adriatic campaign are buried in the Sangro River Commonwealth War Grave Cemetery. This is also the location of the graves of Indian Army men and a cremation memorial dedicated to more than 500 Hindu soldiers killed in the campaign. On the 8th of December, the Irish Brigade set off by truck for winter quarters in towns in the Apennines. The London Irish were initially based in a monastery in Campo Basso.
This is where Ted O'Sullivan spent Christmas 1943, and I shall read a passage from his memoirs. On the 23rd of December, we moved into Campo Basso, and E Company were billeted in the cells of a large Franciscan convent. During the evening of Christmas Eve, the monks carried around a harmonium and sang carols at each cell. The Catholics attended midnight mass, formed a choir, and sang the credo. Our Christmas fare included pork chops. Jim Sadler turned it into a banquet, some of which leaked to the monks.
The brigade's next stop was the front line overlooking the upper Sangro Valley. The Skins were based at Capricotta, which is more than 4,000 feet above sea level. The Fogs went to Castel di Sangro in the river valley. Overlooked by enemy positions on the mountains above, it became one of the most heavily shelled towns in Italy in the winter of 1943. The London Irish were billeted in the small village of Montenero, further to the southwest. This sector of the Italian campaign went into a hibernation for the winter, but Irish Brigade members continued to die. On the 30th of December 1943, Skins Captain Joe Beglin, an accountant from a Catholic Dublin family, aged 31, who had played rugby for Leinster, led a patrol from Capricotta. Corporal David Marshall, a member of the Orange Order from Omagh in Northern Ireland, aged 25, trod in a mine and was instantly killed. Beglin, mortally wounded by the blast, died on his way to a dressing station. Among his last words were expressions of concern for his corporal. Joe Beglin is buried in the Sangro River Cemetery. David Marshall's last resting place is in the Morrow River Canadian Cemetery, south of Altona. The weather was freezing. Heavy snow blocked roads. The Skins were cut off in Capricotta and received supplies by parachute. A patrol failed to return. Its leader was later found to have frozen to death. Two companies of the London Irish at a time were deployed on high points west of Montenero.
The men in the mountains got rest in the town on a rotational basis of about 3 days. During one of E Company's rests, we required a whole sheep. It was roasted over the open fire in the billet and washed down with hot rum toddy. I remember Sergeant Eddie Mayo sitting on his blankets and gnawing at a leg of lamb with blood running down his chest.
On the morning of the 19th of January 1944, No. 7 Platoon of the London Irish was camped out on Il Calvario, a snow-covered peak close to Montenero. The platoon was commanded by Lieutenant Nicholas Moseley, then aged 20, the son of British Union of Fascists leader Oswald Moseley. Moseley was briefing section leaders in his tent when German ski troops attacked under cover of mortar fire. Most of Moseley's platoon were captured. E Company commander Mervyn Davis led a counterattack with his reserve platoon, including Eddie Mayo. Mayo shouted a warning to his comrades before firing a Bren gun at the Germans guarding them. Some London Irishmen, including Moseley, were freed. This is a photograph taken on that day of London Irishmen captured in the attack. Most spent the rest of the war in prison of war camps. The battalion lost 39 men at Il Calvario. Montenero was undefendable. The London Irish pulled out of the village amid German shelling on 26th of January. By the 4th of February, all three battalions of the Irish Brigade had been replaced in the mountains by Polish formations. After resting again at Campo Basso, the brigade moved to Capua, on Italy's western coastal plain, at the end of the month. The weather was improving. Food was plentiful. Reinforcements and men returning from hospital restored the strength of the three battalions. More than 700 of its members had been killed since landing in Algeria in November 1942. But morale was high as intensive training resumed for the next great test. The Irish Brigade were being prepared to join the Allied assault on the Gustav Line in the Liri Valley near Cassino. And that's where I'm going next for part 5 of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War.